friends, and welcome to this new episode of NTB Dialogues, featuring two very prominent WHO consultants today. We have with us here who are working in Kerala, God's own land, not only by way of natural beauty, but also by way of TB control, as we are soon going to hear from them. To my left is Shibu Balakrishnan, and to my right is Rakesh P.S. And as I said, both are consultants at with WHO. Welcome, Shibu and Rakesh, our show. And Shibu, would you share with us what is making Kerala said to be one of the first states to end TB in India, and at least, and what is making it more prepared to deal with the latent TB infection?
Good afternoon, and thank you very much for that question. So Kerala, as you probably know, is having a very robust general health system, supported ably with the political administrative commitment. That system is otherwise managing its health sector very well. I would say that other health indices, not only the TB things or the communicable disease things, but the other health indices are very high in Kerala. You know, the infant mortality has come down a lot. The maternal mortality ratio also has come down a lot compared to the other parts of the country, definitely. And Kerala has achieved something like the developed world standards. With the high literacy and the very good health-seeking behavior, Kerala is set to achieve certain higher indices, including a TB elimination. So what has set the stage for a TB elimination is it's a rapidly declining incidence in Kerala. So if you see the trend of notification of tuberculosis, Kerala has reported it's the highest number of tuberculosis in the year 2009. Only from the public sector, it was something like 27,500 cases. Since then, it was rapidly declining, the notification was rapidly declining, and we thought whether it is really a decline due to decline in incidence or it is a decline due to reporting issue. So we analyzed whether they have gone to the private sector, somebody has really missed those cases. What we found is that concurrent with the decline in the notification in the public sector, the drug sale in the private sector also was coming down. So there is no chance that people are moving away from the public sector and going to the private sector. Then we were analyzing the age-specific notification of TB cases there. What we see is there is approximately 35% decline of TB notification in the age group below 35. And there is a slight increase in the notification above the age group of 65. So that shows there is a epidemiological shift happening. This is what happened in many of the developing countries where TB has been controlled adequately. So this made us believe, this made us confident that yes, if you hit the iron when it is red hot, then we can really achieve tuberculosis elimination. So we tried to see what are the other determinants of tuberculosis. Yes, diabetes is something which is making the people risky to have tuberculosis once they are infected. Then we found that smoking is an issue, alcohol is another issue, then COPD, the chronic obstructive lung disease, is another issue. Then of course, being a healthcare worker, having contact with tuberculosis, then being in a slum area or being in a tribal area, they have some risk, pose a higher risk compared to the other individuals. So we just tried to map those vulnerabilities. So the state health system means the local level, grassroots level health worker, the ASHAs, accredited social health activists, most of them are females, you know. They, with the help of the primary health center staff, the medical officer and his colleagues, they applied a survey questionnaire to approximately 87% of Kerala's population That means 2,45,00,000 individual citizens of Kerala, they were mapped for 13 TB vulnerabilities. That far we have discussed once. But the results, the outcomes of that we have not discussed. That outcome is quite encouraging. What we found is that approximately 3.5% of Kerala's population have some kind of TB vulnerabilities. Means if they have an infection, they have a higher chance to have future breakdown into active tuberculosis. And we also validated the data with whatever has been recorded or notified TB in TB register or NICSHAI database. What we found is that from these 3.5% of the population, 50% of the TB incident TB cases come in Kerala. So now we are very clear. If you manage these 3.5% of Kerala's population adequately by reducing their risk, by providing them probably the latent tuberculosis treatment, then you are going to control 50% of your TB cases in Kerala. So that made the administrators confident, the program managers confident. Yes, this is possible. Then the remaining 50%, that needs probably a passive kind of a self-reporting kind of a thing. This 50% need an active kind of monitoring. So now the state health system is prepared, geared up to offer the latent TB infection diagnostic services and programmatic management services. So I am confident that maybe in another 5 years, whatever the Honorable Prime Minister of India has committed could definitely be achieved in Kerala. Yeah. Thank you, Shobha.
Okay. Rakesh, what about the diagnostic part of dealing with latent TB infection? Because here we are targeting a population which is seemingly healthy and they don't have that risk perception of being disease or any disease. So what is the situation in Kerala? Would they voluntarily come out for diagnosis, and if diagnosed with latent TB, would they go for treatment? What is your take?
Right, so thank you. So basically, like what Dr. Shibu said, the managing latent TB in especially in the context of Kerala, we know the people, we have mapped the people, individuals who are at higher risk of developing tuberculosis. It's not like we are going to test and treat everybody. So we know clearly who are the people. So they are the people who are at higher risk of developing tuberculosis. The government is currently, what is providing is trying to reduce their vulnerabilities also. It's like, for example, if he's a diabetic, trying to control his diabetes. If he's a smoker, offering him smoking cessation services. If he's a COPD patient, he's linking into the Schwass clinic there. So that's again a strength, health system strengthening exercise for COPD patients. Reducing their vulnerabilities is ongoing. At that time, the government also tried to get the perception of the people. There are people who are willing to take, for example, especially the contacts of tuberculosis. They have seen a case of TB. They are willing to take preventive therapy for getting for preventing tuberculosis infection. So they are willing. So we have looked at the readiness there. So they are willing. So what it's going to be basically a concentrated effort only to these individuals who are contacts of tuberculosis with high vulnerability to develop tuberculosis, getting them tested and offering them a treatment, like which is basically like we are waiting for the national policy to come. Like Kerala is waiting for the national policy, but whatever the national policies recommend, we'll offer them a treatment. So hopefully a very very empowered community, very literate people with a very strong health system, Kerala will be able to do that very soon.
Now this 3.5% population which is at high risk, is it some specific group of people, or is it in the general, or maybe children or people living with HIV? If you could just elaborate a little bit on that. And what are the diagnostic tests which are available and treatment also available?
Regarding the first question, like who are these vulnerable individuals, like Dr. Shibu said, we have mapped the 13 vulnerabilities. And most of our vulnerable individuals, they actually look at, if we closely look at, they belongs to contact of tuberculosis cases with diabetes. Because if you look at the proportion of HIV is very less in Kerala. I mean, the prevalence of HIV, it's one of the lowest HIV setting in India. But the diabetes, if you look at, that's very high, like almost around double the national average prevalence is there. So diabetes, tobacco, elderly, contacts of tuberculosis. So these are the risk group, like if you manage. Regarding the second question, what are the investigations available? Right, there are like our conventional thing is MANTO, but more specific thing is coming up, like IGRAs are there. Even based on IGRA technology, new technologies are coming, like CTB is coming, whatever it is. But Kerala state has formed a latent TB infection working group. That group is working on what should be used for, like the government needs a very cost effective intervention. We are looking for the national policy also. So once the national policy is out, I am sure that Kerala will be able to pick up one of these investigations, like very very sensitive and specific tests, basically IGRA or CTB, whatever it is. It's looking for that.
Treatment?
Treatment again, currently the option available, like for the pediatrics and the HIV people, is INH alone for 6 months. So that's anyway going on. I mean, universally all the people, children less than 6 years and HIV, who are HIV, they are getting INH for 6 months. There are other regimens also available, like including INH plus rifampicin for 3 months. There is one other option. Another option is the INH plus rifapentine option, which is again a weekly dose for 12 weeks. So the cost was the only worrying thing, but in this union conference we heard that the cost has dropped down drastically. So either of, any of these three regimens, which the national working group recommend, Kerala will be able to go ahead with that.
Shibu, what is upfront DST being offered to everyone for active TB diagnosis, or what is the status there?
Thank you for that question. But just before answering that question, I will just add to the comments by Dr. Rakesh on the latent TB management. Kerala NHM, National Health Mission, was very proactive in developing proposals for diagnosing and treating latent TB infection in at least two districts as a pilot model, and submitted this proposal where the IGRA, IGRA, interferon gamma release assay, is the primary test, which is very specific, and the 3HP, which is coming up, as the primary regimen. And this proposal has been approved by Government of India. The money has been released. So Kerala NHM is just waiting for the policy to come. The moment the policy comes, the Kerala's some of these vulnerable individuals are going to be getting the first test and treat programmatic management. That's an update for you.
Which are those two districts?
Most probably the highest, lowest incident district, like Idukki and Wayanad, which were selected for TB elimination years before. They could be those districts. And to coming to your question on the offering universal drug susceptibility testing, in Kerala, every district has a gene expert machine, the CBNAT machine. In the private sector, there are another 12 CBNAT machines. They were bought in through the IPAC mechanism, which is a government-supported mechanism also. So the state has now approximately 30,000 people diagnosed every year in the public and private sector together, notified to the program. So the capacity now the state has is adequate to do a gene expert test for all the diagnosed cases. So approximately 30% of the individuals may not have any specimen because they are symptomatic but not able to produce any specimen, or extrapulmonary, very difficult to get specimen. So 70% is the benchmark at any program. So Kerala currently is able to achieve approximately 69% of universal DST for rifampicin.
Okay, yes.
With CBNAT, because CBNAT tests only rifampicin. In addition to that, there are 5 districts which are offering the universal drug susceptibility testing for INH also through a line probe assay. This line probe assay is provided by the Intermediate Reference Laboratory in Trivandrum, and also the Medical Education Department they have set a very good culture DST laboratory in the Medical College Kozhikode, because that department also was very proactive and joining hand with the RNTCP to achieve the commitment for TB elimination. So in that department, there is a line probation machine that is certified, and they are offering the universal DST for INH. So together, these two laboratories do universal drug susceptibility testing for rifampicin and INH. That my point was, Kerala is equipped to offer DST, universal DST, for all the diagnosed TB cases in the private and public sector. But the outcome of that is, once you do a universal DST with rifampicin, what we see is that not more than 1% of the individuals are having rifampicin resistance. Mm-hmm. Means the resistance, prevalence of resistance to rifampicin in the TB population in Kerala is very low.
Okay.
The resistance to INH is less than 2%. So that means probably due to, since a long time, the adherence to treatment was good and the treatment practice in the private sector also was good, the resistance, the probability to risk of developing resistance was low in Kerala. That's what I presume.
Yes.
And there are some evidence also for that. So now the state is able to manage its all TB patients by providing the universal DST. And only very very small proportion have to be managed with a second line treatment.
Now, Kerala is known for its natural beauty, and but still, that natural beauty sometimes unleashes floods and other disasters. So, how do you manage? What is the disaster management system? Although we know that the last floods, not this time, the last floods, Kerala really sprang back to their feet very, very quickly and efficiently. So, how does it impact TB control or TB treatment?
Thank you for that question. Actually, that was a very sad situation. Kerala lost nearly 300 souls in that flood in 2018. And there were approximately 10 lakh individuals were stranded in many of the rescue camps. Because it was a flood, the trauma was not very high. But the mobility was restricted, the access to services were restricted. So, you know, every from every sector in Kerala, there was a joint effort. You know, the fishermen in Kerala were now pronounced as the real warriors, the real navy of Kerala, because they rose to the occasion and they came to rescue and all. Once the rescue period was over in 2 to 3 days, then one of the first thing the health system did is took steps to prevent the communicable disease on one side, and took steps to see whether those who are on treatment for tuberculosis and some of the non-communicable diseases like diabetes and hypertension, whether they are getting uninterrupted treatment. So those patients on treatment for hypertension, that chunk which was on the public sector treatment, they had a line list of that, but not of the private sector. Whereas the TB patients, because they are notified from the private sector and the public sector, the program had a real list of with contact details of all individuals who were on treatment for tuberculosis. So first thing what the program did is was alerted all the district TB offices and the sub-district level supervisors. They contacted immediately their patients over phone and found out that 106 individuals were stranded in the camps. Some 19 patients were missing. And immediately these 106 patients were provided with replenished their drug supply. Maybe a day's loss of drug treatment, and those the 16 people who are not into the camps or at home, they were traced within the next 1 or 2 days. So everybody was brought back to treatment. So no nobody in Kerala lost or got interrupted, his treatment got interrupted because of the flood. But that's only one part. The other part is that Kerala health system, being proactive, they were able to prevent all communicable diseases outbreak also. So after every communicable disease, we expect some waterborne diseases and zoonotic diseases like leptospirosis to come up, but it did not happen. It was a mild peaking of leptospirosis for after 14 days of the, because that's the incubation period of leptospirosis, of the initial flood period. There was a small spike, then that also settled. So because of the resilience of the health system, this is happening. So my point is that TB elimination or elimination of any communicable disease or even control of any non-communicable disease has nothing to do with directly addressing those diseases. But everything is health system strengthening. If you strengthen your health system, you achieve it. If not, you cannot dream it.
And Rakesh, are all the TB patients, are they being screened for diabetes now? Because it has been said it has a high incidence of diabetes. And why so, I'm also interested to know. Is it something in the diet or what is it? And also, are they being screened for HIV or what is the system like?
Right. So about why there is a high prevalence of diabetes in Kerala, we all know, like, in when there is a like epidemiological transition happening in it, with population is growing older, with all development of socioeconomic indicators and all that we have seen witnessed in all the developed countries, there will be a rise of non-communicable diseases. Physical activity will go down, and kind of foods, traditional rather than traditional foods, the other foods will come up. So this contributed to the increase in prevalence of diabetes or incidence of diabetes there. But when we looked at the TB patients, nearly 44% of the TB patients in Kerala, they were diabetes. They had diabetes. So, I mean, this is almost double, 2 to 2.5 times higher than what's seen in the general population. So, after that intervention, the government decided to screen all TB patients for diabetes long, like 5 years back itself. So, all TB patients were screened for diabetes and HIV. And once they were found to be diabetes, they were kept under strict diabetic control. I mean, the primary healthcare team there, they will ensure that diabetes is managed properly. That was on one side, like all TB patients were screened for diabetes. Now what the state started doing is, in all the diabetes clinics, they started training for screening for tuberculosis. Because diabetes is a special vulnerable group, they have 3 times higher chance of developing TB there. So in all their diabetic clinics, like NCD clinics that used to happen at the primary health center and taluk hospitals, they started screening tuberculosis using a 4-symptom complex. Like each and every patient coming to the NCD clinic, a health worker, a multipurpose health worker will ask for symptoms and make sure that they are screened and putting a seal on their this thing, and that's being ensured there. So definitely, yes, diabetes, the population attributable risk of diabetes for TB is almost, it's higher on Kerala. It's like if we control diabetes properly, we could avert almost 20% of TB in Kerala. So that contributes a high proportion. So government is strengthening the NCD control strategies also. In this November 5th, Chief Minister himself is launching a people's movement for having healthy diets, physical activity, and promoting physical activity kind of stuff. So that activities are also going on there.
And in addition to that, the government has also ensured uninterrupted supply of insulin and oral anti-diabetics to all the diabetic patients. They have provided insulin pens and cartridges to all those patients. So that means that vulnerability is going to be addressed. If that vulnerability is addressed perfectly, and that vulnerability is prevented through the healthy diet and healthy activities, what CM is going to launch, if these two happen perfectly, that means the risk is going to drastically reduce. Yes. This is a baseline requisite for the elimination.
All right. Your parting message or anything more which can be done out of the box? Of course, one thing which can be done is that other states emulate the example of Kerala, but in Kerala itself, anything else you would like to share?
the important thing, I mean, the, one of the other important initiatives is engaging the private sector there. Like Kerala government has initiated an initiative called STEPS, System for TB Elimination Private Sector, where all the private hospitals join hands together to ensure that their patients get receive the standards of TB care. It's like a joint effort between the public sector and the private sector there. It's like the patient coming to the private sector, the government is offering the CBNAT by establishing systems there. The patient is with the private sector, government is offering the drugs in the private sector. The private sector will follow the patient from their hospital itself as a part of their social responsibility and finally ensure that the patient completes treatment. So currently, out of all major hospitals in Kerala, 384 hospitals are part of STEPS, System for TB Elimination Private Sector. This is how, I mean, any program, like this is not only for TB now. Through this engagement, any kind of activities can, like private and government sector can join together. But as a result, when we look at the drug sale data, when we look at last year, the rifampicin drug sales was 16 lakh units were sold in Kerala. But after the implementation of STEPS, it has dropped down to 5 lakh rifampicin units. So a 70% reduction in the drug sale that's happening. This will in turn, like this will ensure that all patients reduce the out-of-pocket expenditure of the patient. And this is a way to achieving universal health. So this was one of the messages which I would like to tell. It's a joint effort there.
Right, right. Thank you. And Shibu, your message.
Yeah. Just to add to what Dr. Rakesh was saying, the state has also tried to see what is the drug sale happening in the private chemist shops and to find out what proportion of the patients are actually not getting captured in the notification, the surveillance system of Kerala. So the state drugs controller, the director of health services, the state TB officer, they together have launched a schedule H1 surveillance system. On a single day, those people went out to the private chemist shops and found out what is the sale and who is not there in the nikshay. So what they found is that the number not appearing in nikshay is very, very small. That gave a confidence to the health system in Kerala that might be not more than 5% of the people are not in the hold of the TB surveillance system of the public health services. Means if you just bridge that gap also, Kerala is going to be one of the first states to have 100% notification both in the public sector and the private sector. So my message is that there is nothing called a public only movement, public sector only movement against TB. There is not a private sector only movement against TB, but there is a public movement against TB, the people's movement against TB. If the public and private sector joins hands together, it's a win-win situation. But who wins, if you ask me, it's the people who are going to win. It's not the public sector or the private sector. It's ultimately you and me. So that's my message.
Thank you very much, and I think it is actually a people's movement in Kerala against tuberculosis and against so many other diseases. Thank you very much, Dr. Shibu Balakrishnan and Dr. Rakesh P.S. We had these two consultants with WHO who were with us in this NTB dialogue series of CNS on site from 50th Union World Lung Health Conference taking place in Hyderabad, India. Thank you very much.